in the audience, there were three guys that had short, well-groomed Tony Curtis haircuts, cutaway collar, and just a narrow tie. And I went up to one of these guys and said, "Why are you dressed like this?" And he was smoking a cigarette. He was probably a bit older than me. And he looked down his nose at me and said, "We're modernists." And he turned his back on me. And I felt about 2 inches tall, walked away, and said to one of my mates, "They're modernists. I'm going to be a modernist."
Mod for me is the central look to this whole story. For one reason is it's the only one that still looks great in retrospect. And it comes from a period sometime, no one quite knows, you know, whether it was October the 14th, 1957, when people start to look forward more than back.
Ted, actually, if you look at it, had been very inward-looking. It harkened back to the final great days of the Empire. These guys, who called themselves stylists or modernists, were interested in modern jazz, not rock and roll.
Suddenly their younger brothers, who may have started out with a bit of a quiff and a longer jacket, think, oh, yeah. But when you look at those guys from Italy or France or those American GIs who we've seen going in and out of the jazz clubs, they look cooler, don't they? We got our own
way of talking, yeah. It's about things like the Vespa, as seen in European movies, the bum freezer jacket, as seen in Italian magazines, all those sorts of things, and about the idea of cool.
The scooter element of mod is really interesting because what it does is it gives this teenage generation an ability not to rely on their parents. They're finally independent.
I can remember a V formation of scooters coming down Queen's Road with the sun hitting those scooters and like all the flashes coming off the chrome. And like it felt like someone had poured ice down my back. You know, I got shivers and I thought, God, these guys look like knights in armour on chargers.
This was style. This is pure style. This was finding your tribe through style.
From the ground up, you'd have the desert boots, you'd have maybe white socks, you'd have a nice three-button jacket over maybe a shirt.
It was about suddenly being smart. It was about hair that was, you know, that was close to your head rather than sticking up from your head.
Mod, like almost all of these movements, is originally started by guys. It's a male-led thing, this. It's funny, because you talk about fashion and you think of women, but these are all defined by men, these looks.
It was all about boys showing off to other boys, but then, hold on a minute, there's a couple of girls over there, and they're seeing them dress. And these girls, it was quite bizarre, because they started off by being very androgynine. And in fact, mod boys became slightly more... If you look at some of those early David Bowie, Mark Boland shots from the early 60s, they're quite camp-looking guys.
Teddy boys would have thought, well, we were them puffs. I mean, that would have been the word that they'd have used about mods, there's no doubt.
We had mascara on and we had eyeliner. I had a walking cane. There was a lot of the hand on the hip type stuff going on, you know, and limp wrists and all that, you know.
The 60s are starting to come. We're not there yet. We're probably still in the grey 50s, but these young modernists are heralds of a forward-looking decade.
In 1966, there was a new club open for the younger set called Tiles, which became known as the Mod Club. There were all these new teenagers out there who still wanted a piece of mod, and they spent most of their time fueled up on amphetamine.
Drug culture is yet another facet of the way in which this disenfranchised area of our culture was expressing itself, because it knew that it would create generation gaps.
If you wanted to carry on all night and then end up taking the milk train to Brighton and spending the afternoon on a shingle beach, you needed something to stimulate you. But by the time you got home, to your parents, of course, you go, Mum, no, I don't want any Sunday dinner.
Television by this time had become very big, and so Ready Steady Go, which started in 1963, was seen as the place where you got your information about how to look and where to go to buy your clothes.
Your weekend starts here. Bang, bang. Of course it's going to explode from there. If Mick Jagger wore a jacket one day, or John Lennon, the next morning the shops would be raided to see if they could find the same thing.
Ready, Steady, Go was a much more focused, much more modern show than, let's say, Top of the Pops. But at the same time, because it put mods' enthusiasms, things like Tamla Motown and American black music, on a much bigger stage, it diluted it. And a lot of hardcore mods rejected it, of course. You don't like seeing accurate or inaccurate portrayals of your own culture too widely diffused. You respond to that.
I can remember on my old black and white telly at home seeing the footage of, you know, the mods and rockers clashing at Margate and Brighton and being strangely excited by that. I don't know why, I just was. It kind of ignited something in me.
It was in the papers, so everybody wanted their 15 minutes of fame. They wanted to be part of a pact. People like, especially the British, they like to be tribal and they like to go to war. Suddenly we hadn't had a war for 20 years, so they were making up their own little wars.
By now, we're into the third wave of mod. You know, the first wave, jazz, the second wave, R&B. The third wave was The Who and The Small Faces, you know. Even though it's only 6 years, in that whole time, mod has changed so much. And so to the kids, to the young 16, 17-year-old kids, this was great fun, running around smashing things up, you know. We've always seen it. It happens all the time in British culture. It's a kind of a safety valve.
What happened to that original, simple, homogenous idea of mod were new influences which pulled them apart socially. And I think, on the one hand, there was the sort of upscale London sort of influence which was very velvet. And you can see it in groups who people described as mod and who used to wear mod clothes like The Who or The Small Faces, becoming distinctly corrupted.
All of the guys who start hanging around Chelsea, start taking different drugs, start kind of listening to people who've been to India. What do you get? The kind of clothes get a little bit more fancy and you end up with, you know, bells and caftans. You've got hippies. And one side, the sort of psychedelic side of the mod scene, goes off like that. The other side of the mod scene, in reaction to that, become skinhead.
And you get skinhead as an exaggeration of the neatness, cleanness and sort of defiant roughness. So you get the boots getting bigger and the hair getting shorter, and it's saying, not for the likes of us. It, you know, there's a distinctly refusenik social basis in skinhead.
The hard mod kids who are a bit younger didn't get into all that kind of Pink Floyd, you know, running around doing all that kind of malarkey. It just wasn't going to happen.
The new wave that kicked off at the same time as the punk, where everything was anti-style, anti-fashion, but in fact turned into being an incredible style all of its own, they'd seen the mod look. And they'd seen a lot of the comic book side, but they'd actually adapted it. And I think they gave it a whole new life.
We chose mod for its iconography, not for its, you know, soul music. I didn't know what it was. You know, I think I first heard Green Onions at the Marquee in about mid-1979. Before that, mod to me was The Who, The Jam, The Buzzcocks and The Small Faces.
The mod aesthetic and the mod look has been so durable, and and, you know, looks as fresh today as it did back in the beginning of the 60s, is because it's not frightening, number one. It's not extreme. You know, the Teds were extreme, rockers were extreme, glam rock was extreme, but the mod isn't extreme.
Mod living is an aphorism for clean living under difficult circumstances. That is us. No one can tell a mod, you've got to do that to be a mod. A mod will discover it, but to do it and to live it and to be that, it's quite a hard, informed choice.
Once you're a mod, all the way. From your first mohair suit till your hair's turning grey.